enthusiasts, hobbyists, who have access for the first time to industrial strength making equipment. You know, things like 3D printers and laser cutters, and access to funding through crowdfunding platforms such as Indiegogo and Kickstarter. So they've actually got a route to market, they've got an available, ready, available access to funding and capital. So I actually read a few days ago that the maker revolution contributes $30 billion in value to the global economy. And there are about 130 to 140 million makers in the United States alone. So, you know, it is a phenomenal movement and driven by the Internet of Things, you know, the availability of low-cost sensors, hosting, low-cost processing power, and that's what's driving, at least, you know, partly the consumer Internet of Things. So our first speaker tonight, oh, by the way, unfortunately there's been a change in schedule. Indiegogo won't be speaking tonight. So what we're going to have Patrick to kick off. He's going to talk about his making projects, right? Okay. And then we've got three further speakers, which I'll introduce one at a time. We'll take a brief break for pizzas and beer halfway through. And then we're going to have a panel Q&A session. And then finally, we're going to have the winners of the hackathon that took place in this building over the weekend to talk about the project that they developed over the course of the hackathon. I think it was, what, 24 hours?
75 hours.
75 hours, okay, there you go. And then we'll just finish with some networking and drinks. So over to you, Patrick.
That's Well, thank you for Simon and his team for organizing these events. I've been to a couple now. It's a really good forum for meeting and exchanging ideas. So it's a great pleasure to have a chance to just show you some of the stuff I've been doing over the last few years. So I'm based here at Summer Hall. I've got a studio down in the small animal hospital. It's a kind of old lab which I use for all kinds of different things. And been here for a couple of years now. Formerly I was up at King's Buildings, so I rented a lab at university, but I'm fully independent, so I no longer have a sort of university lab or grant, etc. So that's just a photo showing the lab, absolutely a terrible state of disarray, but there's lots of projects going, and I've got a fish tank. I used to keep seahorses in, but we've got various fish and marine organisms. I'm from a biological background, I should say, so a lot of my projects feature biology, and I think the first time I got into the kind of maker side of things was back in the probably about eight or nine years ago. As I said, I'm a biologist, and I wanted to build a time-lapse system for a microscope. So I've always been into electronics, and I bought this thing that was a Bellman, I think a KO8055 board, which is like a PIC programmable board, and I used that just to turn the camera shutter on and off, and that was my sort of early setup in the lab. So a very manual, simple system, but I didn't realize that you could get all these really cool gadgets and toys based around microcontrollers, which obviously the Arduino, which is Dewey Milanove at the time. So I bought my first Arduino, and then from there I just became obsessed with Arduino and electronics, and I still do a lot of work in the sort of bio side, but I love the electronics too. It's, they complement each other very well. So back, this is back in the day when I was working as a consultant for University of California and University of Edinburgh. I was doing some research on fungi, and that's my mycology background. We discovered these waves of DNA that flow through the colony, and each one of those little dots is a single nucleus. So we discovered this phenomenon, and that was with the help of a bit of hacking, a bit of tweaking on the microscope to get these kind of movies and results. So that was a really exciting discovery. But moving on from that, I love art, the science and artwork fusion. So back in, I guess, when I finished my PhD, I got really into bioluminescence. So these are things that glow in the dark. And I discovered you could get these proteins purified from the marine organisms like jellyfish and grow them in the lab. So actually my first business, which I started back in 2001, we genetically engineered a fungus with these glowing proteins. So it was a kind of mold It wasn't actually growing mushroom which these are naturally growing ones. We engineered this as a biosensor. So basically, the thing glows in the dark, someone poisons the environment, stops glowing, and the light goes out. So that company moved into the oil and gas area, so I stepped down and made an exit from them and set up a new company, which I now call NIPHT Technologies. And that encompasses both biology, art, a bit of electronics, a lot of video, microscopy, and kind of photography work as well. So on the line of microbes, I work with a company quite frequently in London called Kerr Media, who do specialist marketing. And they came to me because they knew that I liked culturing these luminous bugs and wanted to produce a kind of microbial artwork for a commercial. So we developed an art palette using these are living bacteria and fungi. And about 4 years ago in Toronto in Canada, we produced the first living billboard. So this was to advertise Contagion, the Warner Brothers movie. And we basically took an empty storefront, built a giant petri dish, and then filled it with these bacteria and fungi. And you can see on the left there, this is the day one. You can see everything. Within 3 days, the whole thing developed through and produced the logo. And it got a huge response on YouTube. And people were really talking about it. So there's a great buzz about it. Here's another. So I've done a few other projects with Current Media in the more recent times. Just technically how we did it, we projected it onto these petri dishes and then painted them on, turned the projector off. Of course, you wouldn't see anything, but once they start growing, the colours really come through quite nicely. More recently, earlier this year, we did a project at Waterloo Station for Sci-Fi Channel. They were doing the 12 Monkeys series. So again, built a giant petri dish, inoculated all these bugs, and they grew up really nicely over 3 days. That was the end result. And we got thousands of interested people coming in wanting to talk, and they had guys in like biohazard suits handing out flyers and antibacterial gel to the passersby. So that was a fun kind of
happening. The Jesus of everybody.
Well, yeah. I mean, the police. We met some policemen. They were actually quite interested in it. Obviously, it's this day and age, there's all the sort of terrorism threats. But this is a completely harmless setup. The bacteria and things inside are completely safe to culture. So the most recent one I did for with Curb was actually for Lifebuoy. It's a brand of soap which is very popular in Asia. And we did the same sort of thing in a storefront in London. And basically, where the letters are painted, that was the product, and all these bugs kind of grew up around them and created the kind of logo. The video did really well. I think the figures are there, something like 87 million views within the first few weeks. It's actually on the Chinese version of YouTube, but that had a big impact. And then last year, we did a project with the BBC, Magic and Mushrooms, and that again involved lots of time-lapse photography and stuff in the lab. We actually converted the section room here in Summer Hall into a big studio to film this thing, and that was a really nice little project to be involved with. So back to the kind of current projects now. I did a crowdfunding project back in 2012, I think it was. And what I discovered was that when I was building stuff with Arduinos, I really needed something to put them in. So I ended up just cutting bits of acrylic, mounting the boards inside, and using little standoffs to enclose them. Then I found, worked out that I could get these laser cut quite cheaply, and then produced a project basically selling these enclosures, which are, they're modular. So the great thing about them is you can stack them up, so you can put all your circuitry inside, stack them up to build these kind of tower systems, and stops your project from getting knocked about in your bag and you want to take it home. And once your project's finished, you can stick it on the shelf. You don't have like a box full of breadboards and wires. So I got quite into building these little gadgets and devices. I mean, a few things about the crowdfunding is that I didn't ask for a lot of cash. I needed about 1,500 just to get these things laser cut in a big enough batch, so that I'd have lots of left over to do my projects on. Actually, I got about twice the amount of funding I was looking for, so about £3,000. and really successful project. I met some interesting people, a lot of people came back to me and shared their projects with me. And I still get orders for these every week or so. I get someone buying one or two of these cases. So I hope to sell them again. Again, a lot of the enclosures are very cheaply made now. In China, you get them on eBay for a couple of quid. For me, it costs £2 or £3 to make these. So I can't really compete with the very low prices, but they are quality products. And what I wanted to do is just to test the market, really, to find out what kind of colors people wanted, what configurations. A lot of people were using Raspberry Pi, so they wanted to build like multiple layers, like quad processors using these Pi stacked together. So that was a great thing to get into, and I'm hoping to do some more of these kind of funding campaigns. So there's a few examples of stuff I've built with these. There's the kind of kit layout, so you get the two plates, the standoffs, and all the just fixing screws and things. We keep having to adapt it because Raspberry Pi keep changing their configuration. They've now got very handy holes on the PCB now, so you can actually properly mount them on, whereas before they had to literally just sit vertically in the box. So a couple of years ago, I got a grant for an art project, which I called Display. Basically, it was funded by W. And I was fascinated for years about LEDs, particularly when I grew up, the calculators and watches had these really cool LED displays before the advent of things like liquid crystal displays. I should also show us my age, but when my first computing basically was things like the Sinclair ZX80, followed by ZX Spectrum, and then I got an Amiga, Commodore Amiga, which is a really great thing, and ended up trading demos and making discs and things. So the kind of being able to witness this kind of revolution in computing has been a really exciting time. But I kind of like the kind of retro feel of a lot of these old displays that were made in the 70s and 80s. So cool LEDs, they actually get quite warm, these ones. The older ones actually heat up quite a bit. But they look amazing. So I've got various examples here of projects that I've built using these kind of displays. These are all vintage, they're all from the 70s and 80s. This is a clock. Quite a few of the things I've built are actually clocks. And you can pick these up on eBay, but they're becoming more and more scarce. They're kind of more difficult to find kind of very, very old displays. A lot of these were designed for military use, so very high specs, lots of gold and glass and stuff went into manufacture. So a lot of them were very expensive back in the day. For instance, these ones I think were about £50 per piece. So to build a clock like that, be £200 or £300. You can pick them up occasionally eBay for a few dollars. But I've been basically building up stocks of those over the years to be able to supply them as kits for people who want to build stuff and put them into the projects. Homemade LEDs, so these are, I had a go at making them. You get a piece of silicon carbide, chip off a few crystals, and then you pass the current through it, and you'll find the points in those crystals that will actually emit light. So you then break off the piece that's glowing, mount it on a piece of solder, a PCB, and you have a little, what they call like a cat's whisker. It's a very primitive type of diode where you put a wire on the top and you can get the light out of the windows. So the first LEDs back in 1969, Monsanto, so I've got a few of these in this collection that I hold in the lab. They're very, really very dim, not much light at all, but again, they cost maybe $10, $12 each for just one of those single LEDs, and now get them for a penny or so. So lots of cool designs in the chips I found fascinating. So I use a microscope to take pictures of the LED chips, and all kinds of weird Russian ones. We've got some actual diode one. These Russian ones are quite cool because they're just like literally the little semiconductor chip, two wires, then a drop of epoxy resin sealing the thing in a little kind of bead. They're quite cool. I won't go into how to wire them up. Other displays, you've got the Nixies and the Emotrons. I love Nixies, are really cool, but I don't really have them in the collection because I just wanted to specialize in LEDs. And the first one I got was this guy here. This is the Limtronics. There were two main manufacturers, were really Monsanto, Hewlett Packard, and Limtronics. So three guy companies that were making these. And I think HP are still making them.
This is quite a cool Russian one. These are the calculator displays, so these have been dissected. I tend to dissect them and zoom right in at the microscope to actually see the little bonds and the chip die in operation. So yeah, we've got Monsanto, Hewlett-Packard, Electronics. Again, these are, you can buy these now, which are quite cool. You get these in smart phones for a couple of quid. They call them bubble displays, so they're actually quite popular now. They're very, use very low current, so they're very efficient. National Semiconductor, 3-5 systems, I think they might have gone bankrupt, and Siemens, who are also Osram making too. So, quite into the literature. I've got a lot of the old data sheets and catalogs for these, so I've been scanning some of them, just got some really nice stylized drawings of these old displays. And what I'm planning to do really is to rewrite a lot of the data sheets in a very simple form, so that someone who's got an Arduino or a Raspberry Pi wants to utilize them in the project, they just have to look at what we've put together in a summary with the circuit diagrams and stuff. These are more bits in the collection. A lot of them are amazing, some magnifier lenses on them and stuff. One of my favorites, this big guy here, this Hewlett-Packard one. This seems to be, there's no data sheet or anything, it seems to be a prototype chip, and a lot of these kind of things were going, being put into space on the program. So this is a very early dot matrix display. Only ever seen the one of those. Smart displays, so again, you've basically got LEDs and a microcontroller chip or some sort of driver chip integrated in those. So that was from a system at paper factory, actually, for measuring the thickness of paper. What I do is I tend to buy these pieces of kit and strip them down and extract the parts and then build them into clocks. Again, another set. These are probably the first really high-end smart display, cost about $300 at the time, and occasionally again you can pick these up, but they're extremely rare. The sort of more modern form of that display is these little, what we call the 4N54, so these are the ones we've got on these clocks here, and they've got a little microcontroller, a little chip driver in there, which you can basically feed it a 4-bit input, and it gives you the figures. So I build these into the clocks, the decimal points, I tend to use different types of LEDs. For those, we've got the 4N54, so you can see the very simple wiring system there. They come in different colors. Yellow seems to be very rare. Red and green, you can still get hold of those. So again, I will be selling those. Again, these are the first sort of bubble ones that I ever bought, and they're really nice. They've got really kind of retro look to them as well. There's another clock, so a lot of these individual LED displays we multiplex, so we strobe them. Another one with a lifetime alarm in it too. You can see integrated there are these little, this thing here is the chronodot. So this is a real-time clock, keeps very accurate time. They've got a backup battery, so it means that when you unplug it from your power source, it keeps the time, it lasts for up to 8 years. And supposed to be accurate to within a second or two every month, so they're very good. So a lot of people say, why don't you get a PCB made? Be a lot simpler, but I actually quite like the wiring process. I quite enjoy, find it quite relaxing to do the wiring. People call it like a rat's nest or dead bug soldering. I quite enjoy the challenge of doing that, but eventually I will get a PCB made for that. These guys, these little integrated shift registers, the HDSP LEDs, very small chips. I think I've got some examples of those that you can come and have a look at this table. There's a few little examples of those with some messages and stuff scrolling on those. Again, these about £85 per piece. And I was selling them at the Maker Fair for a fiver each. So you can daisy chain these, which is quite nice. Serial inputs, you daisy chain them, you can have lots of them. And finally, just a few of the hack devices that have been created in my lab. Got the Halculator, so this is a calculator that won't do what it's told. I've got the speaking hell. So some of you that are my age will remember this. It's a learning spelling game for kids. So I have this one, and it now says all kinds of profanities. Basically, what's this sign? There's an Arduino chip and an Arduino board. We've got a little speech jet, speech synthesizer board, and one of these LED displays, so I picked a red one. So that, all that stuff, all the guts came out and got replaced. So that's that was a fun one, not for children though. This is a target range meter from a submarine, which I picked up for about 30 quid. And it had these really cool displays in it. So it actually was used in the military, and I've turned that into a clock. So I've got a few of these. There's one up there that's an aircraft display panel. That's what went inside that. So basically, it's a little Arduino Nano on a breadboard. It's got the real-time clock, and the LEDs were replaced. It actually did have the same type of LEDs, but I just replaced them with fresh ones, and again, that's a nice, accurate clock. So any kind of device really can be hacked. It's a smaller one, which will eventually go into a kind of watch-sized piece. Finally, just you know, a few things about the TechCube. We did a lighting installation, kind of earlier, much earlier this year, and decided that to put some lighting right up on the top using LED lights. So the buildings, so these were up on the top of the tower. They're still there, but it was basically with James Harry, who's from the ASCUS lab, which I'll just mention very briefly at the end. These were the just LED strips in the windows. We're hoping to do something a bit more complex using the addressable LEDs. So you can actually have maybe messages scrolling around the top of the building. You have a clock up there, colored effects and stuff as well. So yeah, this is James Harry, who's sitting up the front here. He is the founder of the ASCUS lab, which are just opened up a lab upstairs in the old park summer hall, and are hopefully going to do some really cool projects in the future. So I think that's all for now. And you know, come and see me afterwards if you want to talk about the LEDs, and I'll hand it over back to Simon.
Thank you. Thank you. So our next speaker is going to be Larissa Pichette, is that exhibition from the Edinburgh School of Design and Informatics. By the way, please feel free to take photos, to use social media, for those of you that do. The hashtag is IOT Edinburgh, or IOT EDI, whichever you prefer, both of them work. All the footage is available through web3iot.com. So like I said, please feel free to tweet, take photos, try to interact online. We've got a thread going on the live stream. So over to you guys. Thank you, Larissa. Yeah. Are you all good?
Getting set.
You got to plug in. And then we'll stop, we'll take a brief break after Larissa for a little drink and a bit of pizza. Dr. Timothy.
Right. So how many of you consider yourselves designers here? Raise your hand, designers. One, two, five. How many of you have realized that the letters are actually squished? Great, because that's something that only designers recognize. In any case, what I wanted to get out of this talk is actually to break the usual prejudice, I would say, that designers make things patient. I think there is a long relationship between design and the maker movement, and I think design contributed a lot to the maker movement and the other way around. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. So my name is Larissa Chats. I recently became a lecturer in design informatics. And design informatics is about thinking about this overlaps between design and computing, and how designers can think about better interactions between people and computers, but also how they can learn through engineering methods and computing methods. It's mostly focused on data, but I also have other aspects. So since the Industrial Revolution, design has had this love and hate relationship with craft. So before the Industrial Revolution, design was very much focused on crafts. And then since then, it has much more related to mass production and all the pros and cons that came out of that. But also, even with all the industrialization and the new methods to create products that's not only handmade, design is still very much related to, or the design process is very much connected to crafting activities. So designers usually to create things, they sketch, they build, it's very much crafting. So that's where the relationship with the maker movement comes into being. So this is just a break to say that Design Informatics and also the NIPHT University of Interaction Design is hosting this conference that's hosting next year, the conference that discusses the relationship between making and research. So there will be a lot of discussion about how making and design contribute to new products and so on. So why the maker movement to love design? And so I'm an interaction designer, and I started to study interaction design a long, long time ago. And at that time, there was no Arduino. We tried to build things as a design method. So we need to, the idea is that you need to build things and try things to be able to see the effect in society, and then you would have these things produced, right? So at that time there was absolutely no Arduino. We had to figure out how microelectronics would work. For designers, it's a really long process. So I want to say that a lot of these tools that we use in the design, in the maker movement, actually was born as a way to support designers in this task, or like really early interaction designers, supporting them in prototyping their ideas. So Arduino was born in Liberia, the first interaction design school in the world that invented this concept of interaction design. And at that time, it was revolutionary. So it was like, wow, we can get out of PIC and all these microcontrollers and all this bug. It was really revolutionary. And design really helped to promote that by building cool things that you make use of this technology. They really helped to promote this. Also other tools such as, I don't know if you have heard of fritzing. Have anybody heard of fritzing? Yeah. So fritzing, I actually participated in the development of fritzing at the school where I did my undergrad in Potsdam, Fachhochschule Potsdam. That's where they developed this for designers to be able to produce their PCBs without having to go through engineering tools. Also other softwares like Ego that are much more complex. And even the MakerBot, if you think about it, it was born out of a Raspberry Pi. So I just want to say that a lot of these tools were actually born as a way to support designers in prototyping. So, and of course, why design loves the maker movement? I think that's a bit obvious that these new tools allow designers to build things and test things and try out their ideas. So why did the why design lose with the maker movement? So sketching is a very important aspect in design. So sketching with data, that's a lot of, we do this a lot in design informatics. So we start learning development by trying out different, or by using this data to sketch things that has a design aesthetic or so on. So this is a project I did. Can't really see it, but it has a lot of lines. I just parsed the data from Wikipedia regarding where different citizens can go without a passport. And then you can see the green lines show where countries that have a balanced relationship, so that have, where citizens of one country are allowed to stay the same, that have the same number of days. And then the red lines show countries that have an unbalanced relationship. But the idea is that this is done really quickly. It's a sketch. It's written with a couple of lines of code, but you have this effect and you understand this data really quickly. So you're sketching with this data. So this is made with processing, by the way, which is also made for the lay public. And this is actually what designers usually use to learn coding and so on. This is another project that was made, design informatics. And this is more like sketching with hardware. So what kind of insights you can have by building things ad hoc, right? So you have an idea, you go and sketch as quickly as possible. That's usually the approach in design education. So basically, what it does is just track the toilet roll activity. So you can see how the toilet roll is used throughout the day. So you can, and through this data, you can identify patterns in the data.
I hope you asked first.
I think you got it. This is another project by a student from design informatics, and he's looking at 3D printing and how trying out different ways of using 3D printer to create new materials. So he's basically using this to sketch in 3D into different fabrics, into different materials. So using that as an aesthetic exploration as well. So design also is looking at, into complex issues. And this is a project I have done to look at, it's more built as a probe to understand different relationships to time in the family. So there's this idea that time can be, or technologies can be, can provide full flexible schedules. So I was more looking at that. Basically this clock shows the appointments of a family, and then with a mobile phone you can change these appointments on spot. And then the idea is that you would bring this to different families and see what would change in the family if they can change their appointments on spot, what kind of tensions you create, what is the effect that this flexible time would enable in the family. So the idea is that you have this idea, and then you build something, you bring to their houses, you test it as possible. And it's also more about designing the interaction or design, thinking about future technologies, building them, testing them as soon as possible, and then speculating about what the world could be or what the Internet of Things could be. And then illustrating concepts. This is another project I did with Richard Banks and Microsoft Research. And we're thinking about durability and how I have actually a video. I think about how digital technology could make people to keep things for longer. So what would change if you could count on how you could have your behavior embedded in different things? So it's very speculative, and you can build these things and test them and so on. So it has a memory of our activity. So what would change in your house if everything you interact with would be able to record their actions. And of course, with this tool, you can build it and see the reaction and ask questions. It was also, that was developed by Microsoft Research, so we're trying to speculate about what the future of the phone would be. And of course, design of products. I think that's probably one of the main focus of this meeting today. So of course designers always want their ideas to be produced at a certain point. So of course, as speculative as you can be about the future, how things will be someday, you think about how they will be produced, right? And you want to have people consuming them, interacting with them. I personally don't have an experience of producing anything. I know a lot of people who has tried that. And I'm gonna say tried because it's not that straightforward as I have seen. So this is a very good friend of mine who has built this lamp with Arduino. It's a very normal design process. So the lamp has some robotic features. It's a really nice, it's a kind of a pet that you keep on the top of your table. And she went on to Kickstarter, crowdfund it, she got the money, tried to produce it. It was a lot of work. So I do wonder how this could evolve to actually support designers to make it even more straightforward. Somebody has an idea, or we could discuss this later. So of course there is a lot of, I think this relationship has been productive to both sides, to the design of new technologies, and also to make these tools more accessible for the typing tools. But yeah, I wonder how this could be taken to a step further and actually become a revolution, because there is a long way to go. Anyways, I'm gonna stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Larissa.
Excellent.
Thanks. So, we're talking from Akeli and Good from Indiegogo. And today we're going to have some pizza. Hey. And then we'll have Lorna Crawford from a little company called IBM. Yeah, okay. I hear they're doing very well. And then we will have our final speaker, Ben from Scoop. He's got a really interesting story about taking a product all the way through from concept to production via crowdfunding. So I'm really looking forward to that. Quick Q&A session, and then we're going to have a presentation from the winners of a hackathon that took place in TechCube last weekend. So, help yourselves. Try to make it about 5-10 minutes. So Lorna Crawford from IBM is going to be talking about Bluemix, I think. Watson, possibly? No, Watson
not again.
IoT stuff, Internet of Things, which is kind of the theme of this evening, so that's good, you're on topic. And I'll leave you to it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, first of all, thanks very much, Simon, for giving us the opportunity to come and talk to you people who are there and are the makers and are potentially our next collaborators to take the makings to enterprise solutions, and that's kind of the vision that we've got for it. IBM realises that we go after enormous customers and we're trying to take technologies which we've developed in-house, but over the last few years, and certainly within the last 24 months or so, we've really embraced the fact that the developer community, that young people, that old people, people that have got like industry knowledge, are actually the people that are going to make the changes to the innovative solutions and bring new technology to marketplace. So there's a bit of a tenuous link there to the maker revolution. You might think, what's IBM doing in this space? But really it's about giving you the tools to be able to do that yourselves. So the agenda tonight is just, sorry, it's quite IBM-ish. Sorry, it's not I borrowed this presentation from somebody else. I've thrown in some other screenshots and stuff. But just to talk about what IBM is doing in the Internet of Things space, to give you a bit of an overview about how we're working to build an ecosystem with partners who maybe you'll come across yourselves with Internet of Things, how we're trying to harness that intelligent data and drive new business models, and then some IoT solution thoughts and experiences that we've had from working with lots of young companies ourselves, and really giving you and enabling you with some tools that I'd really like you to take away from today to go and have a play with, to have a bit of an explore and see what we've got available and get on board and join this community that we're trying to develop as well. So, I forgot, it's all these things, let me just bring them all in so I don't have to keep coming back and forth. So, back in 2007, which seems like an age ago, IBM announced Smarter Planet. Has anybody heard of Smarter Planet? Fans. It's like a great marketing campaign, wasn't it?
Just
shouting
around.
Yeah, so Smarter Planet was all about, you know, getting devices and getting instrumentation, sensors, interconnecting them, which is through the internet, and then making intelligent things for business. And to be honest, I'll give you a couple of examples where we've already been doing this for quite a while with some of our customers. My favourite subject, especially on a night like tonight, is wine. So in the wine industry, you know, there used to be a wee man that went about checking how's that grape growing and do we need some more water over here? Is the soil a bit chalky there? And these guys were really knowledgeable and wise, and people like bowed down to them because they had all that knowledge in their heads. And today what we've done is applied technology to those kind of solutions and those problems. To come up with solutions, I should say. So looking at satellite data, like really high, what's the word?
Resolution,
that's the word, thanks. High resolution data from satellites to be able to look and do analysis of the soils. And then also, you know, based on observations at the farm level as well, to try and see what's actually going on. And then from the back of that, we've been able to put together solutions which basically deliver optimised water irrigation right at the plant level, individual plant level, and fertilisation as well. And you can see the impact that's had. That's like 20% reduction in the amount of water that you need to actually give to a vineyard. And if we're looking at, you know, consumables and renewables and all these good words, then it's really, you know, a big massive improvement. And for me, you know, I know that the wine is tasting better on a more regular basis, and I'm not so worried if I can get my yellow label Shiraz at Tesco or if it's not been there for the last couple of years. So it's really having a good impact on myself anyway. Has anybody heard of the Fatberg? Fatberg, London? Disgusting. So we're all kind of, I suppose, guilty of maybe scraping the fat off after you've done the dishes, putting it down the sink. Well, in London, you can think of, you know, this aging infrastructure that's been there for years, hundreds of years. It was never developed for the number of people that are actually using it today. Think about all the different international backgrounds and people that use fat and then stick it down the toilet or stick it down the sink or whatever. And so this stuff all attracts fat, it all lumps together, and they had this challenge that there was this big fat there appeared in the sewer system, and all the sewer stuff was around the streets, and it was just horrific. And so that's a challenge. but can you imagine actually having to, you know, in the olden days we would dig up the streets and we would take all that out and we would deal with it. But now to apply technology to those kind of problems, what we do is we put in sensor technology throughout the system, and now we can analyse where there's going to be bottlenecks and make decisions about predictive maintenance and quality, so that you avoid having to dig up the street in the financial district and think about the impact that that's going to have to business. And then you can do things like actually plan and forecast and build it in with other organisations, whether it's, you know, gas, digging up the gas mains and things like that, and do predictive and smart things that we would love to see on a daily basis up here. I'm certainly sick of seeing things like the trams happening.
So that's had a massive impact. It really, it's a lot more cost effective. I'll do it again, I'll just... That's it.
So, where are we? This year, 31st of March 2015, we announced that IBM is going to spend $3 billion over the next 4 years on Internet of Things. And that's not just about IBM investing for IBM people, it's about giving you, the people that have the ideas, the technology to go and make a difference in the world. So what have we done? Three major areas that we've invested in. So the first one is looking at industries and Internet of Things. And I'll give you an example for you for the IoT Cloud Open Platform for Industries. If you think of insurance, and basically what we're doing is we're providing them the facility to make use of that data that's coming off the vehicles so that we can do things like completely change the business models for insurers to make it so it's a completely individual policy to you that, you know, I know that I drive very extensively across the motorway back and forth to Edinburgh, but, you know, they might not, Adam, my colleague that's here tonight, he might be a bit crazy in the car, and they can analyse the different patterns of behaviour and give you the appropriate type of insurance for you, but also analyse the behaviours of us as groups of people and look at, you know, what's the patterns that we can derive from that and come up with new business models and new go-to-market strategies. We've also got the IBM Bluemix IoT Zone, and has anybody heard of Bluemix before? Bluemix, yes, there are some people. Okay, so Bluemix is IBM's platform as a service. So basically, we've got the cloud, which is our software, it's equivalent of some of the Amazon and Microsoft things you would know. We've got our own flavour of a development platform as well. So in there, we've got things like APIs and services that you can just grab and click and pull together and start plugging together and very quickly realise some business value. And what we've done is we've identified that, you know, Internet of Things is the biggest next thing that's coming along, and we've provided you an Internet of Things Foundation, it's called, where you can go and use Bluemix to start plugging together services. You mentioned Watson, Simon, and it's one of these, it's artificial intelligence or cognitive computing capabilities. Think about what you can do by plugging some of the data off your sensing devices and really trying to get some kind of competitive advantage, with my friend, somebody I was speaking to earlier, and get to market faster than your competition by getting these services and plugging them all together and taking some solution. And also we've got an industry-wide IoT ecosystem. IBM's had partners for a number of years, and we've got very strict kind of channels that we go to market. So normally it's through our distributors, who then sell into our resellers, and they resell the software to the customers. But now what we're looking at is, actually this has changed so massively in the last couple of years that we've developed a completely new ecosystem of partners. It's not just those kind of people that go out and sell products for us, it's also people like communications organisations, people that are actually developing silicon technologies and some of those areas, and we'll talk a bit more about that in a second. There's the press announcement if you want to follow up and have a look at it. So Bluemix, I mentioned, I don't know if it's a small diagram. If you go into the Bluemix website, just Google Bluemix, you can get in there straight away and set up for a 30-day free trial. Then navigate over to the left-hand side to Internet of Things, and then you get presented with this page here, and there's the Internet of Things Foundation, which you can then click and interact with. And I'd really recommend, if you've got some devices that you want to connect up to your computers, whatever, go and have a play about with it and see what you can do, because it could give you a platform that's also free, which I'll come back to in a moment, and you could get some quick business value. Yep, and if you're new to this stuff and you're here today because you want to just start exploring it, maybe a bit, maybe you're doing a computer sciences degree locally, and you think, well, how do I get started? If you're feeling that you really need some help, what we've done is we've put together kind of recipe cards, if you like, on how to plug and play this stuff together and get started really quickly. And some of you sound like you're a lot more advanced than that, so I apologise if I'm talking at a lower level. I'm definitely not technical. It's really easy to use though. I'm not technical and I have actually used Bluemix myself. So I heard that there's, from Gartner's report, something like 4.9 billion connected things in the internet, or connected things now, this year. And by 2020, that's going to be something like 25 billion connected things. When you think about the fact that we are, what, a population of 7.38 billion people in the world, and you know, that relationship is just explosive. It's a massive opportunity. The value of it, talking about numbers, is like, I think it's around about $69 billion this year in terms of market opportunity. And if you look to 2020, I forgot the number, but I'll follow up with you later on. Too many numbers in my head. But it's just saying, you know, specialise in an area, take something to market, grasp this opportunity, it's huge. And you don't have to have the breadth of skills, you can focus in one specialist area, whether it's sensing devices, connection or whatever. So, what we're doing with the ecosystem, as mentioned, is you can see some of the partners that we've got. You know, some connected to manufacturer, distribution, we've got integrators, we've got industry bodies, and we are very pro open standards, open systems. You've seen what we did with Linux, so you might be aware of that, and we're kind of contributing there to try and make everything as open and free if possible as well. We've got IBM programs that are already in place. We've got, for anybody that's at university at the moment, for higher and further education, we provide Bluemix as a platform for free for the whole year. You just have to get in touch with us and we'll give you a 16-digit code and you can start using it immediately. We've also got the Global Entrepreneur Programme and we've got our traditional business partners. Is anybody here a young tech startup organisation? Great, well we've got a programme for you as well. If you're privately held in business less than 5 years and actually the same maximum revenue, $1 million, and if you're actively engaged in developing software solutions which are aligned to IBM's IOT, smarter kind of themes, or cloud analytics, mobile social and security, which we call CAMS, much preferred it than when we're talking about selling smack on the streets, but we've changed that. It's awesome. Anyway, if you don't already sell IBM hardware or software, then we're interested in talking to you about this stuff. Come on board. And why would you do it? Well, we're giving you $1,000 per month, and it's not cash, it's just use of Bluemix. And you can imagine you can start off with a bare metal server if you want a private environment, or you can have virtual servers, shared infrastructure. We'll give you access to things like firewalls and databases and all that kind of stuff up to that value. If you've got a really good business proposition and you think, well, actually, we're worth a lot more than that, we're giving up to $120,000 a year, which is quite substantial and probably more than any of our competitors. So that's all free service there. We also give you access to the IBM Software Access Network, which is everything in IBM, plug and play, use it. Obviously, you would need education in quite a lot of it because it's quite complex. But that's all there. We've got people to help you with that. We give you access to Bluemix as well. So if this was SoftLayer, our cloud platform, this is Bluemix, the development platform. There is a difference, and you get another $1,000 on this one as well. We've got access to Watson through this. So if you want to build in artificial intelligence, or keep using that term, but get turned off on it because everybody thinks I'm talking about war. But talk about cognitive capabilities, then there's an API that you can just plug and play with that as well. Some other things that may be interesting to you, you can imagine IBM's got a massive procurement organisation and we have got access to hotels and, I don't know, taxis and, I don't know, cars and stuff like that. We pass those discounts that we have that we've negotiated at a corporate level to our business partners as well, and that's one of the benefits you can get from a corporate level. We've got SmartCap, so if you've got a solution and you want to get into a pitching competition, SmartCap runs once a year. And you heard of Vicky Brock, she's a local lady from Glasgow, and she's entered Smart Camp, and she got to the global finals and came second or third overall. And then she started using our technology, our SPSS predictive analytics from the software catalogue. And the benefit that she's seen now is that we've actually, she's developed a product and we introduced her to some of our top customers now. So that's people like Argos, Debenhams, and John Lewis as well. So she's a local kind of advocate for this program. We give you business mentors and we get you involved and then we put your solution on the solution directory. And that's worldwide, so we can get you to a global audience or something you might be interested in. And we give you technical expertise as well. So people, there used to be 430 employees, 1,000 employees worldwide. I think we're down to around about 390 now. But a lot of them are technical people with expertise in the industries that you're interested in and access to customers in those areas. So come and talk to us. We'd really like to take the opportunity to invite you to some of our customers. So what we're saying is, harness intelligent data. You know, if you think about the example of buying a washing machine. Today, if you take that home, the people that built the washing machine don't have any clue who you are. They know that they distributed it to the people that you bought it from. And you know, if you're kind of, you care about these things, you might fill out a little form and send it back via the post that says about your warranty. Or you might fill in an online form if you're really advanced. But let's, who would actually do that? Okay, so nobody's really doing that. So if you think about an intelligent washing machine where you put in the sensor data but you also connect it, they now have access to who their customer base is. That's so powerful. Your usage models, how do you actually, is it putting in the dog's towels every 3 minutes at my house because they're boiling in winter? How do you predict that all that dog hair is actually going to get caught in the drum and that there's going to be a problem in another phone? And how do you analyse the outputs from that those sensors to say, actually, that drum's about to fail, get Lorna a new drum before our dog tails get too dirty, quick, and get out there and do predictive maintenance and quality again? So it's about applying that technology to real life examples. Has anybody heard of these guys, Photon Star? It's interesting to see about the light bulbs earlier. So they are a British designer manufacturer organisation of light bulbs and lighting systems. And they're really interesting because if you go into YouTube, they'll talk about their product. It's so quiet for some reason. But Halcyon is a product which is like light bulbs that you put in your house that fit your existing infrastructure. So there's nothing different or advanced about that. But what they do is they give you a wireless system to interact with it, and then they give you an app for your phone. And NASA invested $12 million about 2 years ago in the International Space Station because people that are out in space don't get the benefit of the rising and falling sun. And you actually benefit from, you know, experiencing light and different tones throughout the day, and your productivity goes up. So these guys have taken that intelligence and they've applied it to a product which you can now put into your house. By the way, they also take fancy colours, so if you want to have a disco, that's all part of it. They're one of the IBM ecosystem partners. It's just a kind of case reference that may be of interest to you. And they want to have a look at it. Some of the experiences that we've had, it's too much text here. I'll send you the slides and you can follow up with that one afterwards. But really what we're saying is go and try it, go and experience it, get involved and get in touch with us. We've got a community of other people that are using this technology as well. If you're really keen to understand the kind of finance side of it as well, we've got people that can come in and do business case analysis and all sorts of things. We've got people that can help you through every step of the process. And we really welcome you to come on board. And if you want to get your own kits, you've talked about your own stuff, you know, developed and stuff like that, but you know, it's not cost prohibitive. You know, £20 or whatever. Go out there, plug and play, and get started. So we play in all these areas. Like I said before, go and play with this stuff, have a try, and come back to us and see if you want to be part of it and use some of that facility for free. And I think there's just some links here that we can distribute afterwards. Any questions? And by the way, it was Pete's presentation. He is actually the IOT ecosystem development manager, and he is the guru. So if you've got any questions, feel free to get in touch.
No questions.
No questions, sorry.
We'll do a panel session with Q&A.
It's all right.
That's okay.
Good.
Is that all right?
Perfect.
Perfect. Okay, let's crack on. So Ben's just setting up now, local entrepreneur. Ben Schogler.
Well, that's Ben will do. We can start there.
Okay. It's a very interesting musical instrument. And like I said, Ben's got a really fascinating story. I have heard it before, which is why I invited him along. And I will lead you to it, Ben. You're set up? Good to go?
I can't see behind, I have eyes in the back of my head. I mean, are the things on screen?
Yeah. Yep, you're all connected.
Scoogings. Haven't got sound there, so I'll just do it. So, just a second. There we go. Right, yeah, so I'm Ben, I'm from Scoog. We were founded in 2009, and we make this, which is a Scoog, which is a musical instrument, specifically created for kids originally, kids with disabilities, in terms of like working with an extreme user group. We now got to the point we've launched a new Scoog. Okay. Shiny. It's very nice. Okay. We like him. And we started prior to things like Indiegogo and crowdfunding, so we've done traditional equity funding. We started off actually going through the original kind of university research kind of track. We've spun out. So I'm here to tell you kind of a bit of that story, maybe share some, maybe not wisdom, but experience, I think, probably. But what I'd like to do first off, before I sort of get into the kind of story, I just want to show you a few clips of how Scoog is used and what its kind of applications are. And then we'll talk about it. And I'd like to finish with a demo and a play around with this and show you where it's got to. Okay? So I'll just play this just a quick video of some clips of different people using Scoog. And the key thing is that you saw some users with cerebral palsy, vision impairments, autism, Clarence who's quadriplegic, lots of people, and able-bodied people as well. So used in different ways. And so we started out with the express purpose of trying to create a new musical instrument to address the needs of children in education, particularly people who physically are unable to play a traditional instrument. Music's fantastic. I'm a passionate musician and believe that music should be part of everyday life. And I could soapbox about it all the time, but that's not what I'm here to do. But for I mean, everyone, really. If you can't physically know, you don't have to play a musical instrument, you have a disability. You can't access the thing. And if you actually have a physical disability or a cognitive impairment that makes it difficult for you, it's even harder. But very quickly, before we move on, this was one of our first prototypes in research makes. Okay? And one thing, just in this whole around the kind of Kickstarter, kind of Indiegogo thing that I was talking about earlier, I think it's quite hard for you guys now, because you expect people's prototypes to be a lot slicker now. Okay? Instead of like, why was that not CNC? You know, you can just get a 3D printer somewhere and make it nice. We literally had a block of foam and some tennis balls stuck to it, and we're like, it works! Honestly, just believe me. Look at the, you know, so yeah, it's harder now in a way. You know, you can get things so much quicker, which is really interesting. But one of the things we started, we were working with, through schools and councils, we were embedded through for 2 years in schools and hospitals and places across Scotland, working at the university, working with the target end users. And so we went through the process of really being out there and in the community. And again, I think with the kind of kickstarting to go and kind of make a revolution, some of those people, I think it can be quite isolating in a way. Because it's so easy to actually get an idea, get some things going with that, and even get it funded. You don't, without ever having to leave, you know, the comfort of your internet-enabled bedroom, right? You know, you can do all these things. That I think presents challenges for you, for people as well in development. Because when you're forced to get out there, when you actually have to get your product in the hands of users and test it and evolve it and work on the ground, that brings so much to the story. It's not that the Kickstarter making isn't amazing. Just I think it brings new challenges for everyone. And you've really got to try and network and get out there. And it's something that, I've forgotten the lecturer's name in design. How can we kind of get this kind of problem of taking these fantastic ideas and really making them for products? And I think community is a big part of that. And you know, things like this, meeting up with people, I mean, it's great to see so many people here, but I think it's a really important thing, being able to actually share your ideas and speak to people and get out there and do stuff. So we had 2 years of researching, and then we had that little block of foam. It worked, okay? But another thing I think that is about the whole sort of revolution side of things and make things. So this, if I had a pound for every time someone asked me, is there an Arduino inside it? Okay, no, there is not. Because we weren't working at that time. But everyone just assumes, so you made up with Arduino? No! I can't even spell Arduino, let alone, you know, whatever, use one. But now you can, and that's fantastic. But one of the things that we were tasked with throughout the project was that in order to get to a product quickly, we had to use off-the-shelf sensor products. And that brought with it some challenges in terms of being able to try and work within the constraints of what's available and not just be able to go, well, I'll just build them, you know, as you can do now, which is great. But what it did allow us to do, our first product with Scoog One, was go to market really, really quickly. Because the off-the-shelf product was pre-CE tested, all the stuff was done with it, all the back end was done with it. It worked, it meant that we were tied to a single supplier, which is not great, particularly if they, you know, change their pricing and things like that. You're like, whoa! It used to cost a lot less. Anyway, so you know, things change, but you know, it's a really such a vibrant area now in terms of creating design stuff, but you know, I think there are these range of challenges. So we went to market with the initial Scoog in 2009. You know, we actually had the product then, you know, it looked kind of like this with the colour domes. And it's a new way of approaching music. It's a tactile device. Most technology, even traditional technology, and a quick note on that, instruments themselves, like a flute is technology. Cello is technology. And sometimes people get hung up on music technology being computer-based. Okay, instruments are technology, clothes are technology. Right? And that's coming full circle now in a way, though, with people making smart clothes and using smart materials and stuff, and that's kind of computerizing them, and it's all very exciting. But technology isn't just computers. Okay? And sometimes in our realm, when we're dealing with education and people in music, and some people get quite protective about their instruments. And they say, this is not a musical instrument. And I say, well, I say rude things, but I'm not saying, but it is. Anything that you can make music with is a musical instrument. You know, there is no, you can make music with it. And it's that music is something that is a human thing, it's a thing that people do. Okay? It's not actually defined by the things we make it with. I don't know if you've ever seen the show Stomp, a big West End show, right? Been around for years, I'm a musical snob, I thought, yeah, that'd be really boring. And I went to see it the other day. Amazing. right? If you haven't seen it, if you have an interest in physics, acoustics, sound design, art, theatre, comedy, anything like that, go see it, it's brilliant. And just things like, so they do like a whole scene with just matchboxes, where they make a whole kind of concerto with percussive matchboxes, scraping, shaking, tapping, doing different things. The matchbox is a musical instrument. And it's technology applied in the field to make music. So we evolved this new technological musical instrument, it's a new approach that says you don't necessarily need lots of fancy notes and stuff. You know, what is music about? And what do we need to enable access to music? So one of the key things about it was we created something that was an actual thing, a device, something people could own that had a personality. Tactile, something you could touch and hold and feel, that was really important. Connect yourself physically to the sound. And so we went to market in 2010, we had our product. We'd been through this kind of development phase and we had, you know, all the stuff going. Manufactured in the UK, still manufacturing in the UK. It's quite expensive, but you know. There are also real benefits to having manufacturing on hand. So last week we had to change something on the boards, which meant we could just nip over to Livingston and speak to the people and not worry about the fact that we've made a whole bunch that are now on a container that we need to change, you know. So there are benefits to these things. And we went out, in order to manufacture it and start doing it, we went out and did traditional equity investing. A lot of people, when they see students, see you know, how it works and the impacts it has in the lives of kids and stuff, they go, oh, why don't we go on Dragon's Den? And it's like, yeah, no. You know, Dragon's Den is a format that's taken from the actual investment community and just televised. We've done many things like that, you know, and actually, if there's anyone here, I mean, there's loads of great networks as well for VCs in Scotland, and particularly for startups in Scotland. Scotland has a really good community of kind of small to mid-level investors, and it's around kind of 200 to 300, 500,000 pound mark to get something off the ground. So there are a lot of really great, bright, open-minded people. There are lots of meetings every week, every month. Things like Link, if you don't know it. It's a collection of VCs. And the thing to do, the thing that I would say to anyone thinking of getting into starting a business, or trying to find the capital to start it, either through capital or not, is, you know, reach out to Scottish Enterprise, go to Business Gateway, find the information. It's not easily available a lot of the time, but there's a lot of people out there to help. And as soon as you can get in there, people like Lorna from IBM, you know, you'll have all the connections and stuff. And if people come to you, you're like, yeah, no, I can help you this and this and this. And a lot of the time, you know, people are working in these little isolated silos. And I think that's particularly the case, I think, with kind of crowdfunding stuff as well, because we don't have to necessarily reach out. It's a great portal to reach people, which is amazing. So we did that, we raised equity investment. So far we've raised about £800,000 through equity investment. Don't have any shares left myself, because it's cool, it's all right. That's how it goes. And through the process of working, and we were very much a business to customer, kind of, we were making direct sales. We're going out, in fact, the majority of them, there's nearly 2,000 Skooks out in the wild, as it were. They retail at about £500. So it's quite an expensive item. It's more of an educational purchase, but it can enable everyone from someone with quite profound physical difficulties right through to kind of really able. And it's just a really fun thing to use by lots of people in school, so it's been a good investment for people. And a lot of those sales are almost face-to-face direct, which I've done. So, We had a lot of interaction with our user base, and through the years we've had some press, you know, we were Jackie Bird's fluff piece on the news, you know, several times and stuff. You know, and we've been out there doing stuff. And, you know, trying to evolve our manufacturing, you know, working with partners. And I suppose on the investment front, we were really lucky, you know, we got some great supportive investors at the first kind of actually from the first ever pitch that we did. The guys were in the room, but we did lots more. And they've helped us throughout the years. But one of the things that I would definitely advise is, not necessarily in terms of investors, but when you form a company and you're looking for people to be involved, try, people will come and offer help and mentorship, right? And you may be suspicious of them, okay? Because one, they may be old, right? They say, ooh, dear. I mean, I'm quite old. But get them involved. Having more experience on your board, or more experience around you as an entrepreneur, as an individual who's trying to get something done, it can only help you. It's not going to attract. And these people know stuff that you had no idea existed, or you could do, or you could access,
or even different applications for your technology, your idea, different ways of using it, being able to monetize it so that you can stay on your feet, you can achieve your goals, you can get to where you're going, you can help the people that you want to help. But yeah, be open to people who are trying to help you. There is also, experience around the startup culture that's growing. There are also organizations that possibly maybe seem like they're trying to make money out of you. There are a lot of those. A lot of it in marketing around, Indiegogo and Kickstarter, a lot of people are trying to sell you kind of marketing campaigns and stuff. Some of them are generous, and that's just the way it is. People are trying to make a living, trying to make money. So we did, we grew the product, we do software as well. And we work very, very closely with our users to develop the product. When we first shipped Scoog, we played a couple of instruments, didn't do very much. But interestingly, because it was equity investment based, our investors were like, you need to get that out and sell it. Okay? We couldn't just say, get people to pre-order. Be okay. They're like, no, that's going on shelves, and you need to start making some money on this. But as a result of that, shipping, you start to get feedback, interaction with the customers, and we were able to evolve the product again, and the software, build it out, just make it do what people wanted it to do. And that's another thing. What?
Just a little bit up.
Oh, right, you haven't got wide. All right, do I need to, is there a purpose to this?
Purpose, yeah.
All right, is this when I do standards? Right! Okay?
I'm trying to be subtle there.
All right. No one wants to see me. So, made me lose my train of thought there. I can't remember what I was talking about.
Shipping and interaction.
Shipping and interaction evolving. So that got us to a point, we've had a lot of lessons where we knew what we wanted to do next. And part of working with young people and working with people who didn't have a pre-formed notion of music, how to interact with it, was to really sort of tap into this idea that, music is something that nearly everyone usually wants to do in engagement. It's around us all the time. And if we can provide something that enables you to interact with your music and play music without the need to learn the instrument or know how it works and stuff, which is just a pain. Right? You can still do that if you want, you can evolve to that level. Then this was something we wanted to do. We weren't using the educational thing as a research base, it just kind of happened naturally. And there became these two ways that Scoog was being used. Scoog was being used very specifically for music therapy and in an education environment to assist people with specific disabilities to achieve their dream, being a musician, playing in an orchestra, doing these things. Okay, that was one way it was being used. Great, tick, done that, awesome. The other way it was being used was for fun, which is even better. Okay, people were actually having fun with this thing. And the way they were doing that was not by enduring kind of complicated music lessons, but just using it to play with the music that they loved, the stuff that they, your media loved, what you listen to. And the way that does that is one of the things that we did is, in terms of to play music, you need to not only be able to play the instrument, you've got to know what notes to use, where they fit and this kind of stuff. So we come up with a system with the object that has five sides. We use a pentatonic tuning with it. You can also do all kinds of other fancy stuff. One of the easy ways to use it is just tune it to the right scale, and you become basically free to improvise. And it enables you to interact with the music that you like and just play with it. And you can jam along with Taylor Swift, which is what we're going to be doing in a minute. How much longer? By the way, Simon? Well, can I just do a bit on the Indiegogo?
I've been tweeting.
All right. So we got to the point where we kind of found out where we wanted to get to, right? And we were like, well, and one of the things that we...
Yeah, we really need to wrap up, because we need to do the Q&A.
Okay. So instead of going around this sort of traditional equity kind of route, which is very, it can be a long process, involves a lot of depression, we decided to go on it to go then. And that was a real eye-opener for us. We did that, and we've run three campaigns so far. We've run one and failed pretty spectacularly. We then picked ourselves up, we got straight back on, and we run one, and we did really well, so that's successful grant on that. We've run a couple of ones that have been smaller just to test things. Another thing I'll say about Indiegogo is really great for just testing ideas, testing marketing, these kind of things. It doesn't necessarily have to be all about product. You may already have a product, you just want to kind of get some more information, more interaction with people. One thing about Indiegogo, or Kickstarter as well, Kickstarter is slightly different, they're mentioned different, but Indiegogo, if you are thinking of doing one, there's so much good help online within the structure of the way it works. But one thing that's really important is be careful with your traffic and your PR and your marketing around it, because the one of the key things that you can do in order to kind of improve your ranking and everything is the conversion. So you may do really good PR. This is one thing that sort of was a problem with our first campaign. We did great PR, had loads of visitors, loads of traffic, and magazine articles, and people going, yeah, great, we're like, yeah, we're great, you're great too, yeah. Okay? And they were, but they weren't buying the thing. They were just going, yeah, it's fantastic. And as a result, that really messed with our kind of rankings and stuff that we go. Whereas at the same time we did, we were very careful about who we actually sent to the Edinburgh page. You do your PR and stuff offline of the site, and you try and send just the kind of people you know are going to convert. And that enables you to really kind of raise your profile. So it was a really, really useful kind of learning experience for us. So it's not all about, you know, getting coverage in the FT or the Times and stuff, you know, or in Wired magazine or stuff. Actually, that can be difficult. What you want is that people are actually going to get your thing, get the idea, and then press contribute. So I'll just, can I just do, finish with a very quick demonstration of where the product is now. Okay, but I'll be around afterwards to so yeah. Equity funding, great, it brings a lot of good stuff with it, a lot of help, a lot of structure in getting you out there. Crowdfunding, so quick. And just to be able to see the results happen, fantastic, good for testing. Pros and cons in both, and there's no reason why you can't do both. One is not mutually exclusive, I would say, and I would say just get onto it. So this is the new scoop, right? You'll notice that this one has one of these old-fashioned wire things. Yeah, they don't like that anymore. This one doesn't. This one has the magic of Bluetooth. So wireless is a really big thing for us, to be able to, you know, not be tethered. And it now works with something, these good little tablet devices, I believe they're called. So it now works with the iPad, it's wireless. So connect it up, hopefully. There we go, and there we go, immediately we can play. So the way I saw people playing with their media, so now with, you know, people aren't even buying music anymore, you're just signing up, you know, and be able to access everything for what, it's $5.99 a month, and that's great for music experience and culture. But what we can do is allow you to interact with all of that. So now we can, so I'm here on Scooby Gap here, and I want to make you listen to a bit of tennis. Let's go, the Taylor Swift here, that's style, there we go. We'll play the tune, it's very nice. And this now is automatically. It's in tune. So immediately, all of my media is interactive. I can now play with it. I don't have to know scales. I don't have to know how to play an instrument. I can start creating, doing different parts. I can take it further. Scoob also works in control of GarageBand. It's like a 70-dimensional, tactile, multi-faceted super interface. Right? Get one now. But what mostly is fun, right? It enables kids to start being creative musically with music that they want to play with material that's inspiring and engaging, and I think the buzzword is age-appropriate, culturally relevant. Okay, these are the two things we put in the grant applications. It's very important. But yeah, so, and that's been a long process, but you know, I suppose the getting to this point through crowdfunding and being able to test it, and this, you know, evolving app and testing with people, something's come out of that, it moved so quickly. So I think it was a real benefit to us on top of the more traditional kind of equity investment. But I could probably talk for 2 or 3 days, so should probably stop there. Thank you for your time. Hope you made it interesting, and I think we'll have questions in a panel-y type of thing soon.
And do a panel-y type of thing. So with the speakers, please come forward, grab a seat.
Laser into the retina situation. We'll just maybe. The concept.
the participatory design was 2 years. And it's now 2015, so...
I'm making questions, so...
Yeah, I was wondering, okay, yeah. So that was the first one, your question.
Can I ask you?
How long it took?
Yeah, how long it took from the design...
Good question, well done.
To the production and commercial.
So on the commercial side, I was saying the idea started in 2002, but from the design process, I would say 2006-2008 was we did a participatory design process. So we had the production prototype, and we had the partners, and we were ready to go. And then I think production could be, well, we made them in-house with these things. That's how we manufactured them. We make them all ourselves. So I think manufacturing might be a slightly highfalutin way of doing it. Scoop 2 has probably been a couple of years still. Although, again, design back and forth. We've created a whole new type of sensor, built loads of IP around it. It's a whole bespoke kind of thing. So it's not just wasn't just re-engineering that for different materials of manufacturing, we've actually recreated. Well, what we can create a new type of tactile sensor technology and work on Bluetooth in certain ways. So there's quite a lot gone into it, but it'll probably 2 years again.
So let's open the floor to questions, first of all.
Yeah.
Of course you can. Just to actually introduce yourself, that would probably be a good place to start.
I work for digital medical as an imaging scientist. SD working data analysis.
Load of ideas in the IOT space, the maker space?
In analytics.
In data analytics, yeah. Okay, specifically.
One question which sort of bugs me about is, how do people get over this question of securing what the idea you have, like how you sort of
secure IP protection.
You go through it first, or you make things first?
That's a really good question, because I'd be a bit paranoid about the best idea ever to put on a crowdfunding platform and find that someone replicates the campaign. What's to stop them, right?
It's an interesting story. One, I would say, just get on with it, right? You do get, and I'm from an academic background, in academia, you're very protective of your ideas, very protective. And that's really, it just hurts you, it slows you down. In our situation with Scoob, what happened in terms of IP protection, go see a lawyer. You know, they'll give you a consultation for an hour for free, you know, and then you'll know where you stand. But with us, the people we were working with needed the PR from the work that we'd done and announced to us they were going to do an article about it in the Times that was going out the next day. And we were like, but if you put it in the public domain, we can then patent that and then build a business around it. So we had to do a patent in 12 hours.
Oh my goodness, I didn't know that was possible.
It wasn't. Very good guys, a firm at Edinburgh, and give you their name.
Wow.
And we got it actually, that Scoop 1 has, it was granted. So there you go. But just don't let it worry you. Go and seek advice. Don't let it kind of shut you down and get it out there.
I hear in the startup community, the tech startup community, that ideas are dime a dozen.
Yeah.
And it is so easy to replicate these days. You've got to be super agile. And no matter how much you attempt to nail down the IP, someone, if they're determined enough, they will find ways to circumvent the protection. So you see it all the time. It's all about implementation, execution. That's the really hard bit, getting it to market, establishing the brand, getting that loyalty behind the product, and a little bit less about IP. I would say that's my view on things.
Can I just add that, of course, you've got to gauge what your product is worth. So something that might be worth 100 grand and you might make 50 grand profit on it, then I wouldn't go that way. If something's going to be worth 10 million, then it's worth it because the file patents.
Vans are expensive. Yeah, I've been through the process numerous times. Yeah. It is. Particularly when you start entering non-English territories, the translation costs are prohibitive, so you've got to be pretty sure that those territories like Japan, for example, are worth entering, and you have to get all the documentation retranslated, and it can be very costly.
And then you have to pay to enforce it on a yearly basis.
Yeah. Of course, So and if you're a small guy, there's no prevention, they're thinking, well, possession is 9/10 or whatever it is, so if we swipe the idea, it's down to them to sue us, and because they're a multi-billion dollar company, they're not going to have the capability. You can get IP protection insurance, but it's really expensive. And again, the economies don't really work out often for early stage startup companies.
Trade secrets, you know, company secrets, patents, everything's out there, so people can just read it and they can do something quick.
Causal ambiguity, sir, is another one where your competitors can reverse engineer, but because there are so many almost hidden sources of competitive advantage, it's difficult for your competitors to nail down exactly why you're able to outcompete them, and that's another, that's again process innovation.
I'd say the main benefits to us from doing IP stuff was in securing investment. So investors they want paperwork, and if it secures you the investment, then it's worth it.
Was there any
Hey?
Did anyone copy this?
Not yet. There's a couple of slightly different kind of versions. No one's copied yet. I'm hoping someone's going to copy it soon, which may mean we're onto something.
Imitation.
Maybe it's just not very good.
Imitation is the best form of flattery.
Yeah, exactly.
So mixed feelings about that, but hopefully they will at some point or not. Right, shall we move on to the next question?
Me.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm
what's your name?
James.
And
I've done, I sort of do art design, so I've done art residencies in Fab Labs. I did one in Montreal and one in Fab Lab London. So I made some stuff there with all the materials. And this is a question that I'm really interested in at the moment, is with the maker movement at the moment, it's really, you know, vibrant and energetic and it's all open and stuff like that. How do you see the future of it going when things like 3D printers and laser cutters go down in price and people can go back into their rooms and just do it themselves? And do you see it like the community thing getting lost, the make, learn and share kind of thing sort of going away as people can afford these machines?
Collaboration is essentially what you're talking about.
Yeah.
People continue to collaborate out of necessity or desire.
Yeah.
I think there are certain people who will want to get out and meet, and there are other people, you know, the lone genius who will just prefer just to hang out in a shed doing their thing.
Yeah.
I don't know what you think about that.
Yeah, but I also think that it's not that easy to be creative with these machines. The worker showed by Diego is exactly like this fight about how you can be innovative with 3D printing, because of course, you can reproduce a lot of things, and then it's probably cheaper to buy in the shop around the corner.
Yeah.
But to be like truly creative with these machines, not that easy.
I think it's about sharing resources, isn't it? Because I keep looking for an excuse to buy a 3D printer, but I just don't have a need for one. So I'd rather interact with some other guys who've got a 3D printer and then share my stuff with them, and then we get sort of dialogue going, and it's getting those interdisciplinary backgrounds together and getting people talking and sharing resources.
I think with the different crowdfunding platforms and the maker movement, there is a lot more. Although it's becoming cheaper, you say people maybe get more. I think there's a lot of community. I mean, even just running a campaign, other campaigns get in touch, and it's just social and marketing, or you may find you've got, you know, similar manufacturing problems and share stuff. And I think there is a shift in that, and so much so that already quite big organisations are picking up on that, and they're building these kind of hardware startup incubators either out in Hong Kong or this. They're all springing up all over the place now, and they're kind of taking this real specialism from the manufacturing industry and helping, you know, bridge that gap between the small community, the makers, and actually, you know, the ones that can make it into the mainstream.
What's the big one? Is it PCI International something? Highway 1?
Yeah, Brinks and you one. That's an Internet Things one.
They're popping up, aren't they?
Yeah.
And they just handle the entire process. They've already got the supply chain.
Or even just bits. They're incredibly open.
Yeah. I mean, they take their pound of flesh, obviously, in the form of equity in most cases. But in most cases, it's actually worth giving that equity to have access to that, manufacturing facilities in China, so you don't have to do that. Helping with the product design, the marketing, the mentorship, and so on. So a lot of the hardware accelerators, often sponsored actually by innovation funds, so that, you know, the big guys, taking some of the retained profits and very sensibly investing in early stage in startups. Any other questions?
Questions for the project. How many LEDs do you have?
Sorry, Gary. I'm actually going to get you to stand up and talk about. So So it's Gareth from...
I'm Gareth Edwards. I work for Xilinx, FPGA company based here in Edinburgh, but I'm also a director of Edinburgh Hacklab, which I guess is our local makerspace here.
So the actual figure, it is in the millions, because if you look at some of the LED displays, that's 500 LEDs in them, and I've got maybe 1,000 of those. So I've got probably, in terms of unique displays, probably about 200 different types, some of which I've got one off, some I've got 2,000 off. So it's trying to find the ones that are useful and keep a stock of those.
Good evening all. Patrick, I've got a wee thing.
Introduce yourself real quick.
Sorry, thank you for having me. I knew it was going to feel that it's too late or something. David, I'm a competitiveness specialist. Competitiveness specialist.
Oh, okay.
It's a posh name for being a marketer, but you don't want to say a marketer.
Yeah.
I'm a marketer now. I used to be industrial chemist working in electronics. I used to be a medical microbiologist. I want to work with Patrick. I've always wondered what I wanted to do, but I think he just gave me a lead this evening. Generally speaking, just quickly on the subject of crowdfunding, being a marketer, it's elegant. Yeah. You know, testing the market, crowdsourcing, knowing crowdfunding, all that kind of stuff. But the crowdfunding platforms are not there for us. They're there for themselves, and they're very, very poor at putting the two components together, which is the market and us, the projects. In fact, I asked them that question, what the hell are you doing? And they said, well, nothing. Because I said, well, you're not bringing a market to me, what are you going to do? And they said, well, you're supposed to bring the market and the product. And I thought, well, that's...
And who's this, though? Which can you
this
name?
This is Cindy Google. And others.
It's a shame they're not here too.
And others. Well, I did ask her the last time she was in this room, actually. Anyway, sorry, my question, I guess, is there scope for somebody to crowdsource a maker's community? So we don't have that problem, so it's at least a bit more evolved. So when you get really good meat and you've got supply, and it's just haphazard in
it. There's active
automators and all sorts of things going on there, algorithms, but there really isn't some kind of process that matches people together.
Like a Spotify.
It's a long question, sorry.
You could, like a Spotify, things you could buy, things you might want.
Yeah,
it's the same model, the product, and product. Yeah, but I'm pretty engaged because I blog about this stuff, and actually what I would like to have is a control panel which gives me all the crowdfunding projects that I'm specifically interested in. I'm not really interested in someone who wants to crowdfund an opera, for example. It's got to be connected technology, and I want that fee to come from Kickstarter, Indiegogo, and lots of the more niche obscure ones as well. We can really get the gold dust, but they don't bubble up because they don't get the visibility. I don't hear about them, I don't vlog about them. So I think you're right that there's still a great opportunity there to put the two together.
Like a platform of platforms. Yeah. We've got an IBM platform because we've got IBM Watson Personality Insights, which can take a Twitter feed from somebody you might want to participate with, analyze a profile and see if they're the right fit for who you want to actually go for. So you can build that for yourself.
Watson is, I mean, who knows what Watson is? Raise your hand, IBM Watson. And the power of having access to a mega super duper computer and having via API the ability to plug that into your own company, leverage that. And there are some really exciting startups who have access to it. They're doing some interesting things in healthcare, and I'm sure we'll see more success stories come out of it. So, any more questions?
Can I make a comment on that?
Of course you can.
I think one of the problems is also the timescale. One of the problems of this crowdfunding platforms is that people who contribute expect like an immediate product, and the time scale to produce these things, at least from a design perspective, is huge, with years, right? So I don't know if there is a way to match these expectations of contributing and getting something back and waiting, being able to wait years to see this out there.
The platforms are so far behind the rest of us, which is understandable. Just new.
It could be a niche.
Could be.
Okay. So I think we've got a couple of announcements. Do I have a really quick question? Are you sure? Okay. So we've got a couple of announcements. This is like a quick open forum, usually what I do right at the beginning of the evening, but because we've got such a packed schedule, we'll do it now quickly. So Gareth, you've got an announcement, I think. Anyone else?
Yeah.
Jeff? Do you want to go first? Okay.
So, I don't care a lot about money at Edinburgh. People are interested in the thing, maybe away from the mobile, I think. One of the challenges of mobile is making money out of all the previous things we've done with mobile. So, the next Mobile Monday is going to be about making money out of mobile, about monetizing. We're going to talk about advertising, we're going to advertise intelligently, we're talking about affiliate marketing, and we're going to be talking about how you actually make money out of App Store. We've got Amazon going to talk about the App Stores. They're done around with Europe, we've got Sky Cash, we've got affiliates, and we've got Delta DNA's head of insight talking about how to be intelligent with advertising. 23rd of November, joint controversy for the business school, Google for the one on the Edinburgh, we'll find this. Hope to see you then.
Perfect, excellent. Welcome to the joint, so I'm not talking to you. Hi everyone, as I said earlier on, I'm one of the directors of Edinburgh Hacklab, which is one of the maker spaces here in Edinburgh, I guess. We're based in Summer Hall, not very far away, right next to the pub, which is awesome. We have things like the laser cutter, which is working at the moment, but going soon. We have 3D printers, we have electronics equipment, we have the ability, electronic CAD, and all this kind of thing for people that want to try and do stupid things with electricity, which is where we started off with people with that. What we've talked tonight about community, I think the most important thing we have is our membership. There's 45 members there. If you come along with a problem, you'll probably get 45 different opinions on how it should be solved, but one of them might be right, so you can always use that as well. Open nights for Tuesdays, generally speaking, from about 7:30 onwards if you want to come in, or check out the website. You can email the info address, and we have a reasonably active IRC channel as well if you want to talk there. So if anything tonight has inspired you to come and actually build something. We tend to be more of the physical building rather than software side of things down there at the moment, but there are some software people as well. So
thank you.
So please
follow up. Fantastic. Great. Thank
can
you.
Can I make an announcement?
Yeah.
We're hiring at the moment. we're looking for digital marketing, we're looking for some entry-level position, and we're also specifically looking for some iOS development. So if anyone's interested in better school music, get in touch.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Please thank our wonderful speakers. We're now going to get a presentation from John, Johnny, Liam and Paul.
Powell.
For just a moment. Thank you. Round of applause for our speakers.
Doesn't like it.
My name is Johnny.
I'm John.
And we run the project management, market research, and business direction in the project.
I'm Liam. This is Pavel, and we were the nerds for the weekend.
We have a fifth member, Gordon, but unfortunately can't be here tonight. So yeah, we were given three goals: the theme of digital participation, inclusion, social housing, libraries, and personal finance. So we kind of took that and took a twist. It's still relevant, but we think we've come up with a really good idea after a lot of brainstorming and research that will really benefit society, we hope, through the means of technology. So what if we could give you the means of donating to the homeless with the assurance that your donation was always going to make a positive impact. So yeah, we propose that you change that.
As Johnny has just introduced us, introduced to you guys, we are ChangeCard, a non-profit social enterprise. We are a team of five that came together last weekend at Project Forge, united in changing the problem of homelessness for the better through the use of digital inclusion. This change will be brought through our idea of the Change Card, a card that will enable you to help the homeless. The Change Card will be a redeemable coupon that you as a consumer can buy in-store, then donate to those less fortunate living on the street. This will ultimately allow the homeless to go into stores and buy the goods they need. Now let me tell you a little bit more about the Change Card. So this piece of socially responsible street art was created by Australian artist Meek in a very Banksy-esque style. Although legal, to vandalise it on the wall is home to, it provides a powerful message. Giving a homeless person a few spare coins just doesn't go far enough. You can buy maybe some, the homeless person can maybe buy some food, or it could possibly fuel a dangerous drug addiction, and possibly the same drug addictions that put them on the street in the first place. The fundamental point behind the image is that political and social change is necessary to solve the problem of homelessness in the long term. Without concentrated efforts by governments, private companies, and society as a whole, thousands of people around the world will continue to go day to day without adequate housing. To make matters worse, we now live in a society where coins, cash, and fiat money are becoming less and less useful. Thousands across the globe are using contactless card payments and moving to other payment systems such like Apple Pay. Soon, people like myself and you guys won't even have the spare coins in our pockets to donate to those less fortunate living on the street. So where does this leave those poorest in society who cannot fend for themselves? Who fights for the man who cannot fight for himself? Our team aims to tackle this problem of homelessness and be part of the change to end it. Hence, we introduce you to the Change Club. I want you to imagine yourself, or cast your mind back to the last time you were passing in front of the storefront. Beside you is a man less fortunate than yourself, sits out here day and night. He's asking out for a few spare coins. I want you to cast your mind back, what went through your head? I only have my card, so I can't give him any spare coins. I wouldn't want to give him spare change anyway, in case I feel any dangerous drug addictions. I can maybe buy him a sandwich or a coffee. Chances are you went right on by and you did nothing to help the poor soul. What if, however, you go to the checkout of the store and saw a card on sale specifically for helping homelessness as a problem? A card that upon our purchase acted as a coupon redeemable for specific stores, specific goods in store. We would like to add here, we do not believe that all homeless are addicts to drugs and alcohol, especially not after meeting some of the homeless we did last weekend. We'd also like to add that we know the problem of homelessness isn't just that on the street, but is a larger problem that is within our community. But the coupon is purely to be redeemable in a safe fashion, to give consumers peace of mind that they're making only a positive impact on the lives of the homeless, and of course for pragmatic business reasons. In the short term, the Change Card will provide sustenance to the homeless. It will provide them with the means to purchase food and clothing without any physical money needing to be present in the transaction. And more importantly, it gives the homeless a choice in what they buy. The Change Card will address homelessness in more than the short term, however. It will address the issue in the long term. The Change Card has two unique features to it. One, it will only be redeemable once. And two, it will have expiry time limit to it. All money that is not used in the first redemption or is on the card after its expiration will be pooled collectively to what we call our spare change fund. The spare change will be used to invest in long-term projects to help change the homelessness problem on a more permanent basis. It'll support projects such as like the one Shelter carry out within the local Edinburgh area, and hopefully go on to include further e-learning skills that can be taught online for such skill sections like life skills. And hopefully, this will bring only positive impact. So in the short term, in the immediate, the homeless person is getting sustenance, they're getting the basic food and water they need to survive on the street, and in the long term, positive impact goes to longer term solutions to solving homelessness as a whole. Companies who decide to participate through the change card concept will benefit massively as well through the corporate social responsibility opportunity. We know nowadays that companies are trying to do more and more to help the communities around them, so we view this as something they'd be very keen for. Hopefully, companies will lead the path in improving the community around them, and they can inspire the rest of society to follow in this change. Through the data gathered from change cards, the government will be able to analyse which areas have the greatest homelessness activity, how reliant the homeless are on the generosity of the public, and how begging gangs affect the homeless. This can hopefully give greater insight to the government on this black economy, and for governments to implement new policy to bring about real change. Consumers will feel confident that upon purchase of a change card, they are also making a direct positive impact in changing the problems of homelessness. They can also directly see this impact online now, which is where I'll pass you on to Johnny, who will tell you more.
Yes, so we have a link to the website. Awesome. Right, so yeah, this is a very, very basic prototype of what we want to achieve from our landing page. As you can see here, there's a slogan, very original, I know, taken from the same page, so on. Keep your coins, we want change. So I guess this is the message that we're trying to get out. You can see here, there's the four stages of our system with the change card. If you want to scroll down to the change wall. So in order to get our products out there, we're using like a sustainable, low-cost approach to marketing. So when you go in and buy a change card in the store, you're actually given a receivable, a redeemable token. You can come back home, go onto our website, and create an account, which can be synced with your social media. So when you sync with your social media, you can use that redemption code, and the amount you've donated will be put on your balance. So you can share with your friends of your generosity. Also, you can see it from our homepage. So in real time, when you redeem your token, your profile picture will come up, and everyone in the country will know that you're part of the change. We're going to add an insight section to the landing page, so there'll be an interactive map that shows the most growth in each area of the country, just so each city can compete and tackle the problem. There'll be a bunch of graphs and fun information as well. Do you want to scroll down to the... Yeah, awesome. We'll have this fair change section too. John briefly mentioned that, so that's like the whole point of what we're about. We're using the guys in the street to help them whilst also helping the entire homeless community at the same time, because we know the homeless community is much, much larger than those you see on the street. So we're really trying to tackle the whole thing. I'll pass you on to the guys who made all the magic possible and the tech side of things, and they'll give you a brief demo of the kind of concept we want to take into the high street.
Yeah, I'll talk to you really, really quickly because I'm staying late about the tech stack we used. So we had like basically 48 hours to build sort of end-to-end proof of concept. So we had a front end, which is what you see here, and we also had a back end to collect all the data. We exposed an API for our fake point of sale to interact with, and we had a fake point of sale, which was essentially an Android app with a QR code scanner, which allowed us to simulate both the buying of the card from the consumer and the redeeming of the card from a homeless person. I can give you a quick demo video here. So essentially what you're seeing here is the purchase of the card by scanning a QR code. And you can see there that was went through successfully. So now the user could log into our website. Slowly.
Securely. How are you using Blue?
And here we can actually check the status of the card. So the consumer is given a receipt with a token on it, and this is that token being put into the website. And you see there, we can tell that the card is active, so the homeless person is still in possession of it. So now this is simulating the redemption of the card. So this would be the homeless person going in store, handing it over to the person at the checkout and redeeming the value of it. That was successful again. And you can see here that we can now track.
We would like the code push without who could make it so far and for the immense amount of support. And speaking about shoutouts, you can reach us on Twitter at changecardpf And now we'd love to hear your feedback and if you have any questions.
Their suspended meal program is something that kind of gave sort of part of the inspiration behind our concept.
I only found out about them on Saturday afternoon, so yeah, it's a great idea. really good stuff to do. Oh, thanks.
Any feedback at all, we'd really appreciate it.
Yeah, even afterwards, if you've got any comments.
Any concerns?
Concerns, yeah. Go on to hear it.
Thanks. Flawless, guys.
Right, well, we've got a little prize for you guys. This is the CEO of 2C, which is super fast text entry for small screen touch devices. There you go. And for smartwatches specifically, but in car, smart home appliances, whatever. We've only got two bottles though, guys. So you want to open one. So congratulations. Really impressive.
We knew each other from university. We never spoke about this sort of thing.
Really? Wow, really impressive. And such a noble, worthy course. So thank you so much. Right, okay. I think we'll wrap up there. The next IOT Edinburgh event is on the 30th of November, the future of drones. We are going to wrap up the live stream now and go to the pub. So there's a pub right close by, literally, just on the other side of the... courtyard, I guess, is probably the best description for it. We're going to head over there now. What's the name of the pub, Alan?
The Royal Edge.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.